Daniel, your prophecy will reveal the secrets to the end of the world. Stay faithful. Stay brave. And no matter what, obey the commandments of the Lord your God. Deciphering Daniel with Pastor Jim Scudder, Jr.
There was once two boys named unusual names. One was Mind Your Own Business, and the other was Trouble. And they decided to go play a game, and one went and hid while the other one counted to 100. And so it was Mind Your Own Business who was looking everywhere for his brother Trouble. He looked out, all outside the house. He looked in the garage. He looked in the garbage cans. But Trouble had really hidden himself well. He started to look at the cars on the street, looking under the cars and in the cars, when suddenly a police officer rolled up to a stop and jumped out and said, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Mind your own business. What are you, are you looking for trouble?" He said, "Yes." You know what? There were three Hebrew boys that were minding their own business, but trouble found them. So that's the question. What happens when trouble finds you? What happens when we go into trials in our life? How do we handle that? What do we do? How can we get through them? And that's the message that we're going to find in Daniel chapter 3. Although before we start talking about chapter 3, let's talk again about the first couple chapters of Daniel. Daniel chapter 1 was the narrative of how this all happened. How did they get into this dilemma? How were they in a foreign country, young men? So the Bible tells us that there was a king that had finally convinced a group of tribal leaders to coalesce into an empire, and they conquered some other empires, and now we have the first global empire. They controlled much of the known world, and the king was Nebuchadnezzar. We know him in history as Nebuchadnezzar II. But he went and conquered Jerusalem and led away some of the best of the best young people into go back to Babylon with him. And there it was, Daniel. We are introduced to a young man named Daniel who took a great stand. He said, "I'm not going to defile myself." He had purpose in his heart, and you know what? He took a stand. He said, "I'm not going to eat of the king's meat or the king's drink because I don't believe that those things served to me were killed properly, processed properly. Maybe they were probably the wrong type of animals. It wasn't according to the dietary law that God had given to Israel, to the Jewish people." So he took a stand, and God blessed that. And I believe his stand encouraged three others to stand. And then they were found to be 10 times better when they were quizzed by the king. And then in chapter 2, we read about the king having a dream, and he couldn't remember the dream, and he was going to kill all of the wise men of the kingdom. But then Daniel and his three friends prayed, and they prayed hard, and God answered their prayer. God answers prayer. And so they brought the dream and the interpretation to the king, and the king had dreamed of a statue. The head was of gold. We find out later that that was representative of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. And then we have successive kingdoms, arms and of silver, the waist and thighs of bronze or copper, the legs of iron, and the feet of iron and clay. So we know that Babylon would be conquered by the Medes and the Persians, and then Alexander the Great in Greece, and then the Romans. And then this seems to be a revision of this empire. It's very weak, and it's supporting a statue that is top-heavy, right? And that's, I think, a picture of all Gentile human governments right here. It's all top-heavy. It will all fall. A stone made cut without hands hit the feet, and the whole statue is destroyed. We have a chart. If you're listening on our radio program, this is a little more difficult for you, but you can get this chart on our website, and the chart gives you the statue. Of course, we had to lay the statue down to make it more timeline friendly, right? So we have Babylon that corresponds in chapter 2 and chapter 7, both as Babylon, the beast, the lion. And then we have the Medes and the Persians, represented by the lopsided bear, and then Greece by the leopard, and then Rome by a terrible beast. And I believe, again, that empire will be revived there after something we call the rapture. We're in this age right here. We're in the middle from the time of Jesus till now, until Jesus returns. We're in something called the church age, and it's a time of parentheses, and then eventually the Lord will return for the church, and we will forever be with the Lord. And then there's this seven-year tribulation period where the Antichrist will be revealed. We're going to get into that a little bit today, but these are important prophecies, and that's the timeline. And then Christ returns, the rock, comes back, and conquers all of man's attempts to govern ourselves, sets up a kingdom, and that kingdom will have no end. So that is the book of Daniel, at least up to this point, where we have found ourselves. But we have Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or their Hebrew names, Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael. Their names were changed to reflect paganism, really. And Daniel 3, they're given a second chance to bow down to this image that Nebuchadnezzar had made. No, he wasn't satisfied the image in his dream, just the head was gold. No, he wanted the whole statue to be of gold. So in chapter 3, he builds this huge statue. Remember at the end of chapter 2, though, he says there's no other God like your God, because Daniel had interpreted and told him the dream. How quickly we forget the lessons that God has shared to us. And then you also find jealousy. Daniel really saved all the other wise men of the kingdom. But now, a short time later, how many years? We don't know. Probably just a few years later, chapter 3, he builds this big golden statue near Babylon in the plain of Dura. And the statue would have been as tall as the Statue of Liberty, not including the base of the Statue of Liberty. And then when the music was going to be played, everyone was supposed to bow down. Now, Daniel wasn't in the story, so Daniel must have been sent by the king on official business. He wouldn't have been in the area, and therefore he wasn't part of the story. But I love the fact that his stand in chapter 1 and his trust the Lord in chapter 2, trusting the Lord in chapter 2, it builds faith for his friends. I love to see when one young person does right, that's contagious. And that truly is contagious. And if you're younger here, I pray that you would commit yourself to doing what is right, because it's going to affect other people in a positive way. Now, obviously, the same thing can happen in the negative way, right? So we need to be people that will take the proper stands no matter what, and then see God work. And now God has worked in these three lives, and they said some incredible things in Daniel 3:17, if it be so. Remember the consequence. If you don't bow down, we're going to throw you into a burning fiery furnace. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able. Would you say that with me? Is able. Okay? Our God is able. Do you agree with that? Our God is able. Our God is able to do anything. Our God is able, they said, to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. I love that faith, because it's true. He is able. And he will, this is really interesting to me, he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. Now in the next verse, they say that he might not save them from the burning fiery furnace, but even so, either way, they will be delivered from the king. You say, how so? Well, let's say that fire in that fiery furnace had consumed them, and within a short amount of time, they would have died, right? It would have been terrible, but they would have died. And then instantaneously, because of their trust in the predicted Messiah, they would have been with the Lord. So now they're delivered from the hand of the king.
Or God could somehow miraculously save them from the fiery furnace and they're delivered from the hand of the king. So either way, as Christians, it can't be that bad. The worst case scenario, my dad used to say, the worst thing that can happen to you is you can die and go to heaven. All of a sudden, it's like, oh, that's true. So why am I all fearful? Why am I all scared? You know, when things come our way that we don't understand, it's easy to lose it. It's easy to be distraught and start to question God. You know what? I hope when we come to these fiery trials in our life, I hope that we will take a stand and say, my God is able, and he can deliver me, he will deliver me from this. It might not be in a way that you're expecting, but he will deliver us. Daniel 3:18, but if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods. They took a stand, and this stand could have, would have led to their death, to their demise. We will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Very clearly, God had told, really, he tells all of us, it's one of the commandments, Ten Commandments, not to worship false idols. And therefore, they took that stand, and they said, we're not going to do it. Verse 19, then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury. I mean, I wish we had a video of this. You've seen in the cartoons when the guy gets just so upset and it turns all red and steam starts coming out of his ears. You've seen those in cartoons? I think that's Nebuchadnezzar. I think steam literally came out of his ears. His veins popped, I'm sure, in his neck. He was so upset because he'd given them a second chance. The form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore, he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 1 7 times more than it want to be heated. I mean, this is already a forge. This was probably used to create the statue. It would have been large enough. We are later told that they were walking around, three of them, and then a fourth inside this furnace, so it wasn't a really little forge or kiln. It was sizable, big enough for four people to walk around and be able to see into. And you don't need to heat it up 7 times hotter than it already is, right? Actually, it would have been smarter for Nebuchadnezzar, if he wanted more of a painful death, to put them in when it wasn't as hot, because they would still die, but it would be more agonizing. You know what happens when you lose your temper? Now, there's such a thing as righteous anger, and we need to sometimes get angry about unrighteousness. We truly do. But there is a danger. Most of us don't have a problem with righteous anger. But we do have a problem with unrighteous anger. Temper. So what did this accomplish to him? Well, he actually was so upset, he became foolish because he heated it 7 times hotter. Their death was quicker, or would have been quicker, and we'll later read that he had his mightiest men put in these three, and it was so hot, and the fire leapt out and killed his mightiest of men. Do you see what anger does? Do you see what just coming unhinged can do? It's something we have to be very aware of and very careful about. Someone has said that a person full of fury is full of folly. And I totally agree with that. This call to worship really, really reminds me of the fact that the world has over and over again and will continue to try to unite religion in opposition of the one true God. This happened at Babel. You all remember the story of the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11? It happened in Babel where they were going to build a tower and they were going to make a name for themselves. Actually, let's read it in Genesis 11:4. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower. We know this city
was called Babel and the tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. So this was a grand, tall tower, as tall as they had the technology to build. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered upon the face of the whole earth. This was shortly after the flood. Man came out of the ark, and God said, I want you to fill the earth. Don't stay in one place. Why? Well, because God wanted to replenish the earth, and also because I think God knows the power, what people can do with power, consolidated power. You know, and I think God said, no, I don't want that. I want, because of the sin nature that we have and people taking advantage of that consolidated power, I don't want that, and I want it to be spread over the whole earth. He did that after this. He said, no. He confounded the languages. They all spoke one language. And by the way, evolution can't explain this. And if you look at language families, there's about as many language families as there were grandsons, great-grandsons from Noah. It's exactly what the Bible would have predicted, about 100 language families, and there's a lot of variation within those families. But God said no. They were building this tower, and next thing you know, they asked for a hammer, and the guy heard Hammerstadt or something like that. I don't know, whatever the words were. You German people just laugh at me. So if I even got close, by the way, that's pure luck. I just made that up. So it was confusing, and they were like, what's wrong with you? And suddenly, it was great confusion, Babel. And so they broke away from that, and they had to do what God said to do. But there's a day, the Bible says, when the whole world will be united, and all of the power of the world will be consolidated in one person. This is extremely dangerous. Extremely dangerous. And this is predicted in Revelation 13. And part of this unification of the world will be a unification of religions. Just like there in Babylon, right in the same area of the Tower of Babel, Nebuchadnezzar is making people bow down to an image that he made, and everyone had to do it or they die. Fast forward to the future, in Revelation 13, verse 11, it talks about another beast. Remember, there was the first beast is the Antichrist. This is another beast that had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. So he will come with this appearance of a lamb. The Bible also calls him the false prophet. He will be one that will gather the religions of the world together to unite behind the Antichrist. But he speaks as a dragon. You have to be very careful listening to his words and knowing what he has to say. And deceives them that dwell on the earth by means of miracles, as we'll talk about in a second, that he had a power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image. Isn't that interesting? An image to the beast. The beast that had the wound by a sword and did live. So there was probably an assassination attempt on the Antichrist somewhere in the middle of the tribulation. This is a future 7-year period that will begin with the signing of a comprehensive peace agreement with Israel and its neighbors. And of course, the Palestinians would be included in that. So this Antichrist will now say, okay, you're going to worship me. And the Bible speaks of something called the abomination of desolation. We won't have time to talk about that now, but we'll talk about this again in Daniel 9 and Daniel 11, because Daniel mentions this abomination that maketh desolate, and Jesus mentions it in Matthew 11 and talks about, or Matthew 24, and it talks about this, what Daniel spoke about was still future. So we know it wasn't when the Greeks desecrated the temple. We know it's still future. Right after Jesus, the temple was torn down. So the temple's going to have to be rebuilt, and the Antichrist will desecrate it. Probably part of the desecration is this image. And this false prophet will get the whole world together to worship this image. This image had power to give life, or the beast did, unto the image of the beast, and that the image of the beast should both speak and cause many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. I mean, doesn't that sound like what we just talked about in Daniel chapter 3?
You don't bow down, you don't worship, you die. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bound, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. Now, a lot of people are really worried about this, and you should be. I believe the Bible teaches that we won't be here for this mark, but there will be a mark, and it's more than just, let's say, a computer chip. It's more than that. It's an outward visible mark that shows allegiance to the Antichrist. So mark in the right hand or the forehead. If they don't have the mark, they're not going to be able to buy and sell, except for the one that has the mark, the name of the beast, and the number of his name. And you wonder, where do we get 666 from? Right here. The number of man, 600, 3 score, which is 60, and 6. 666. So it will be incorporated somehow into this mark, the number of man, the number of the Antichrist. And if you don't have that, you will die. So it always comes back around, doesn't it? Now, something happened in the last few weeks that I'm not saying that what I'm about to say is what we're talking about here, but what I'm gonna read a story from the New York Times, something that just happened recently, is for sure a precursor of this attempt to unite the world religions. You have to unite the world religions in order to coalesce around one leader in a governmental way, in a monetary way, one world currency, one world government. So the religion, a unification of religion, has to be part of this. And something happened that's never happened before. A pope visited Iraq. Now, where was this plain of Dura? Where was Babylon? Where was the statue, this image? It was in what's modern day Iraq. And Pope Francis went to Iraq, and I'm not here picking on Catholics. I truly am not. There's a lot of Catholic people that I know that are really wonderful people. Catholics also have a history of taking great stands for life, for the unborn, things like that. But I'm just telling you that he does lead more people religiously than any other leader on the planet. And he went to this region, and this is what he said, as a pilgrim of peace, seeking fraternity and reconciliation. And again, we're not opposed to someone seeking peace, but we're opposed to that person seeking peace outside of the gospel, the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, right? So according to the New York Times, in gestures concrete and symbolic, Pope Francis on Saturday used the backdrop of an ancient Mesopotamia as a powerful reminder that what binds humanity can be more powerful than what divides. They continue, in his historic visit to Iraq, Francis has sought to lend support to Christians in the majority Shia country, urged Iraqi leaders to protect all minority rights, and sent a message that he himself is back on the global stage after a year of the pandemic. Of all of Pope Francis' journeys, none have taken him as close to the site of the roots of monotheistic religions as the windswept plain in southern Iraq, which remains with the remains of a 4,000-year-old temple dedicated to the moon god. And in the shadow of that ziggurat, he proclaimed that we should do away with war and bloodshed and using certain things to accomplish that. Fraternity. He spoke about these things in the place where Abraham was born. Now, we respect Abraham, right? I mean, Abraham was a man of God. He believed God. It was counted in him for righteousness. It wasn't his works. It wasn't his willingness to offer Isaac that saved him. That's what showed us his faith. But he was saved when he believed God, when he was leaving Ur of the Chaldees. So it is a man that we would highly respect. Of course, we know Islam also respects Abraham, and so do the Jews. So if you're going to try to unite the three monotheistic religions, you're going to probably look for someone like Abraham. Doesn't that make sense? And that's truly what I think is happening here. That's why he went there. And again, we're all for protecting minorities and making sure there's less bloodshed and less wars. But the Bible predicts
the world religions will unite, and I believe we're going to see a big push from today on, and we already have, under the causes of saving the environment, of economic equality, which is really socialism. And I think also thrown in now is how to avoid a pandemic. So these are global issues, right? The pandemic, isn't that interesting? The coronavirus has affected every nation. Every nation. And so we will think that we will have to globally come together to defeat this and to defeat economic disparity and to defeat ruining the environment, right? Those are the causes that we're going to probably coalesce around. We'll have to try to save us by doing these things. So I did a little reading about Pope Francis, and I read that a couple years ago, he went to the United Arab Emirates, and they agreed, him and Muslim leaders, agreed to a document called The Human Fraternity for World Peace and Living Together. And let me quote a little bit of that. In this agreement, it says, "In the name of God and of everything stated thus far, the Muslims of the East and West, together with the Catholics of the East and West, declare the adoption of a culture of dialogue as the path, mutual cooperation as the code of conduct, reciprocal understanding as the method and standard. We who believe in God and in the final meeting with Him and His judgment on the basis of our religious and moral responsibility, and through this document, call upon ourselves, upon the leaders of the world, as well as the architects of international policy and world economy." It's interesting how a religious person is including all of these other entities into this call for unity, "to work strenuously to spread the culture of tolerance and of living together in peace, to intervene in the earliest opportunity to stop the shedding of innocent blood and bring an end to wars, conflicts, environmental decay, and moral and cultural decline that the world is presently experiencing." He calls upon intellectuals, philosophers, religious figures, artists, media professionals, men and women of culture at every part of the world to rediscover the values of peace, justice, goodness, beauty, human fraternity, and coexistence in order to confirm the importance of these values as anchors of salvation for all. Now, he speaks of salvation here. But, and I would love to see an end to evil. I would love to see an end to wars and bloodshed. I would love to see all of this, but the Bible tells me that that cannot happen until the Prince of Peace comes. And that's what we should be seeking and preaching isn't coexistence, but the gospel of grace through Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 14, 6, "I am," do you know this verse? "I am," let me put it up on the screen, "the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." So there's no way of salvation outside of faith in Jesus Christ, but nowhere in that document is mentioned Jesus. And that bothers me. And it's not just the Pope, it's you're going to see more and more of this cooperation among religious leaders, and you're going to see less and less about Jesus Christ. That's just how it is. And the whole world will fall in line. Now let's get back to Daniel chapter 3. In verse 20, now remember, the king is really, really upset now, and he commanded the most mighty men, I mean, he took the best that he had, right, that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and I don't think they probably resisted. I'm guessing they didn't resist at all, to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their hosen, their hats, and their other garments, so They usually would, if they're going to execute someone, they would often strip that person and then execute that person. But they were in such haste that they didn't do that. They kept all their clothing on, everything, even their hat, and they bound them. So this is important. And they were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Daniel 3:22 says, "Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace exceeding hot, the flame of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Isn't that crazy? How hot that must have been. The people throwing them in died. You think they're not going to last seconds, right? And it would have just been a hideous thing to see this beyond even our imagination. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound into the midst of the burning, fiery furnace. And you say, oh, Pastor Scudder, you're saying if I serve God, this can happen to me? Well, anything can happen to you. Now, God could have prevented them from going in there. God could have sent them on official business somewhere else, like Daniel. Well, why did God allow them to do this? I think it's for you and for me to see what God can do and to see the miracle and experience sweet fellowship with God in that fire. Nebuchadnezzar, verse 24, the king was astonished. Why? He rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did not we cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. And he answered and said, lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. What? What is happening here? This is unbelievable. Because they did not take the easy path. They took the hard path. When you're an electrician, they teach you that electricity will always find the path of least resistance. As a pastor, I've seen many Christians take the path of least resistance. It takes a lot of work to be the husband that God has called you to be. When you have committed, promised before God that you are going to be faithful to your wife and you're not going to look on any other in a sexual way, and it does away with all of that, and it's not the easy path, and you're going to get home and you're going to be tired, but if you're going to be that man that God has called you to be, you're not going to just flop down and turn on the TV to watch March Madness, but you're going to look around and find ways that you can help and show her how much you love her, and then you're going to be able to maybe spend some time playing with the kids, helping them, talking with them. It's not the easy path. Or maybe you have a boss at work that is just a terrible person and really hard to work for, but the hard path is following Jesus' words that you're going to treat that boss like Christ. It's not the easy path. It's not the path of least resistance, but it's the right path. So you're gonna do the things that are right, but they're not gonna be easy. They're gonna be hard. But let's say you do that. You do those things that are hard but right. What are you gonna experience? You're gonna experience God in a very unique and profound way. Here we find they're walking around. I mean, they threw in three and now there's four. That had to really freak them out. Instead of being bound, now they're free. So I think they bound them probably with ropes. The only thing that burned when they got thrown in were those ropes. They were bound and they threw them in and they fell down in the fire. I wonder what they experienced. What would that have been like to be in the midst of an inferno? Certainly, I don't think it was hot. I think they felt. Have you ever been outside on a beautiful spring day when it's warm but it's not hot and there's a beautiful breeze, the birds are chirping, you know, just that wonderful feeling you have? I bet that's what it was. They're like, wow, this is pretty cool. I'm enjoying this time in this burning fiery furnace. They're walking around, they're checking things out, like, how is this happening? They must have been in shock. Instead of writhing in anguish, they were walking around. No attempt to come out either. They could have just come right out, but they didn't even make an attempt to come out. They were just standing there walking around, checking it out. And then, now there's four.
Who was this fourth person? Well, Nebuchadnezzar said the fourth is like the Son of God. There's some debate on this. Was this an angel or was this the angel of the Lord? We call that a Christophany, a pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus Christ. I feel like Jesus himself was in that burning fiery furnace. And they got to fellowship with him. This happened with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. It happened with Jacob. Remember, he wrestled God. He wrestled the Lord. I believe that was probably Jesus in Genesis 32. A few other times we find this in the Bible. God making an appearance in human form. This was pre-incarnate, so he wasn't in his earthly body, permanent body yet, but certainly Jesus always existed. He was always the Son of God, and I believe he appeared there because they had taken such a profound stand, and he was going to encourage them. And he said, you know what? I could have called them into a conference room, and we could have had this same experience, but this is going to be much better if I called them into a furnace room to have this conference. I mean, what a unique and profound experience. And if they hadn't done what's right, they would have not had this sweet time of fellowship. And for centuries, we've been talking about them. We've been talking about them. And that's encouraged us, I think, to be people that will take a stand no matter what. And God will deliver us. He might allow us to be instantly in heaven with him, or maybe he'll spare us from this trial. Either way, how can we avoid, or how can we get through a fiery trial? How do we face a fiery trial? By doing what is right and allowing God to do his miraculous work in our lives. Daniel 3:26 says, "Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither." I don't know if you've ever been close to a really hot fire, but the closer you get, you can just feel it. And it's this intense. I remember when we had one of our college outings, and it was in the winter, and everyone's dressed up with, you know, heavy coats and heavy, like, snow pants. And I remember our dean of women, you all know, Jane Vasquez, was sitting there warming up by the fire, not realizing it that her snow pants were melting. And, you know, the closer you get, especially in an inferno like they were, and so the king's coming near the mouth of this furnace, certainly he's feeling the intense heat rolling off, but he is so impressed by what's happening, he's got to be there, and he says to these Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, "Ye servants of the Most High God, come forth, come hither." I hope that's what you're known as, servants of the Most High God. So he says, "Come out," and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire. The princes, governors, captains, and the king's counselors, remember, they're the ones responsible for telling on Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to get them thrown in there, being gathered together, saw these men upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was a hair of their head singed. That's the first thing to go, right? You're lighting a grill and it goes, whoop, and you're missing your, you know, hand hair, knuckle hair, eyebrows. That's the first thing to go. And sometimes you don't even know it till you smell that smell. Isn't that a terrible smell? I smell that, I'm like, uh-oh, go check the mirror. And this is even a greater miracle because the king left their garments on them and they came out. And I'm wondering if the king grabbed them, looking at them, no signs of any fire, any singeing. And I bet he brought them close and smelled their garments. Now, I have to confess to you, and that very few preachers will ever do this publicly, but I'm a smoker. I think smoking is a good thing. I think everyone should do it. I usually go and smoke in the backyard. I have a green egg. It's a grill. Oh, you thought, no. I'm sorry. No, smoking meat. But I'll go out there and I'll light the grill. By the way, I don't believe smoking is good, just so everyone's on the record. Okay. Of course, it's not good. It's bad for you, and it's bad testimony. I won't say any more than that. But smoking meat, on the other hand, I'll go out there, and I'll just
all I'll do is light the grill. I'll be out there for about a minute. I'll come back inside, and Karen can smell the smoke permeating my clothing and my hair. It's incredible how quickly smoke will permeate your body. And they didn't even smell like smoke. This was a miracle of miracles. And the king was so impressed. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, "Blessed," in verse 28, "be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." Now, don't you wish he got it this time? Remember chapter 2 at the end? He was so impressed with Daniel's interpreting the dream and giving him the dream. He said, "Your God is a God of gods and King of kings." But then he forgot that. Now he's saying it again. You know, this "blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word and yielded their bodies that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God." What a testimony. Profound. And I believe through the ages, from this point on, we don't see Jewish people bowing down to idols anymore. That's why they were in Babylon, because they kept disobeying God and worshiping the pagan idols and other things. Now they saw this. They saw the stand. And a testimony can go so far down the road, blessing so many people. And now the king is saying in verse 29, "Therefore I make a decree that every people, nation, language, which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces and their houses made a dunghill." I love that. That guy, I can't wait to meet Nebuchadnezzar. I think he's in heaven. Not because of this, because of the next episode in his life. He finally learned about the true power of God. Because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. Chapter 3, quite a story. Pretty profound, pretty incredible. And I think also symbolic. This story is symbolic. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar, I believe, represents that whole statue, the head of gold, which is the Gentile nations dominating Israel. From the time of Nebuchadnezzar until today, there has not been a rightful king sitting on the throne of David in Israel. There is one that is coming back that will sit on the throne of David. He's coming back to the spot where the last righteous king of Judah, the rightful throne of David, fought a battle in Megiddo, Josiah, and he's coming back to that spot to fight the final battle of Armageddon. And we have an amazing story that's symbolic of not only the Gentiles' domination that will come to an end, but the deliverance of Daniel and his companions is symbolic that God is going to deliver Israel, the Jewish people, from the final onslaught of the Antichrist. Now, Isaiah had predicted this, and I love this verse, and I think this is a verse that you can write down or memorize. He had predicted this some years before in Isaiah 43:12, "When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee." Now, do you remember that happening in the Bible? They passed through the waters, the Red Sea, passed through the rivers. The Jordan River was held up as they came into Jericho. "And not overflow thee when thou walkest through the fire." This was a prediction of the future of, I believe, these three guys. "Thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee." Does that mean God will pull you out of every trial? No, he might let you go into a trial for his glory and for you to get an experience that you never would have had any other way. It was a year ago on this day that I was in Florida attending to my dad as he was in the hospital. On this day, we didn't know that he was dying yet. I think in the morning, I felt like he had improved a little bit, and I think I gave a report to the church. Pastor Paul preached. I don't remember if we were closed down yet on services, but maybe we were. But I think in the afternoon, I learned that he wasn't going to recover, and that was a trial. But in that trial, we saw Jesus. And then we've had to go through another family trial. I've given you some vague descriptions of that, just a personal trial that our family's had to go through. And it's been a tough trial. It's been really, really hard. And there's not a day that it doesn't affect me. But I've seen these three young men survive a fire. And I saw Jesus with them. And so that tells me that he's with us. He's with us. Live a life of obedience. Don't let anything stop you from serving him. There's a lot of things to be worried about in this life, right? There's a lot of things to be worried about. Let's just all live by these verses, Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. This is the Christian life right here. You receive him by faith. You walk by faith. Jesus Christ empowering you. I had a man come up last Sunday, a really good guy. I like a lot, good man. But he was really worried about all the things that are happening in this world. He was worried about the COVID vaccine. He was worried about vaccines in general. And I understand that, and I'm glad that vaccines aren't compulsory, and I hope they never are. I think if they are, then we're really in trouble. You'll have to do your own research on that. But here's the thing. We can have a lot of things distract us from walking by faith. You know, and we can spend our whole life trying to avoid healthcare scam or whatever it is. You know, we're really bothered by election fraud or whatever it is. We can spend our whole life focusing on that, and then we're going to miss serving the Lord and doing the things that God has called us to do today, which is to give the gospel. The answer is Jesus Christ. The answer isn't vaccines. I actually I find that a lot of the vaccines have saved us from a lot of things, but that's my opinion. But the answer isn't vaccines. The answer isn't science. The answer isn't let's just all unite around human fraternity and around Abraham or whatever. The answer is Jesus Christ. Because this verse ends by saying, the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's all that should matter to us. That should be everything in our lives. Don't get distracted by other things that aren't eternal. Have you put your faith in the Son of God, the one that appeared in the fiery furnace? Have you trusted in him to save you from a worse fate, and that's hellfire? He wants to take you out of that fire and set you in to a place called heaven. But we all have sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death, and that's bad news. Eternal separation, eternal punishment. Jesus said that God so loved the world that he didn't want us to spend eternity separated from him in a place that he made for the devil. He loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son, this is Jesus, that whosoever, that's anyone, believes in him, that's to trust in him, should not perish, that's hell, but have everlasting life, that's heaven. It's a simple message. Why do we miss that message? We want to save ourselves. We want to be part of our salvation. When the Bible says all you have to do is believe, trust in him, Jesus. Jesus came. He lived a perfect life. He died on a cross. He had the fieriest trial of all. He died on a cross because upon him was our sins placed. And he died that day. He rose again the third day, and he's alive, offering salvation to anyone who believes. It's by grace that you're saved through faith. It's not of ourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. How can I be saved? When I realize that Jesus paid for all of my sins. This is our sin, and this is us. He paid for all of our sins on a cross, and he's inviting you to receive him by faith. And when you do, you have eternal life. And now you know that your destination is heaven, and you have someone that's going to walk through the fire with you on this earth. It's the greatest thing in the world, and it's free. All you have to do is put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and when you do, he has you in his hand, and there's nothing that can harm you. Ultimately, God is able. God is able. Would you please bow with me as we close in prayer with your heads bowed and eyes closed? I want there to be a quiet moment between you and the Lord. Have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Have you trusted in him as your Savior? Had the privilege of speaking to our addictions ministry Friday. We had two people raise their hand to indicate that they were receiving Jesus Christ. And that salvation is offered to you, to everybody. Have you ever put your trust in Jesus Christ? Have you ever said, Lord, I'm a sinner. I can't save myself, but at this moment, I put my faith in Jesus. If you haven't done that, do it right now. And if you are doing that, it's not your prayer that saves you. It's Jesus that saves you. You're trusting in him. And if you've done that, can I pray for you? Can I rejoice with you? I won't embarrass you. I want every head to be bowed right now. But would you hold your hand up right now and say, Pastor Scudder, today I put my trust in Christ. Is there someone? Just hold it up for a second. Let me see you and I'll pray for you. I won't embarrass you. Between you and the Lord, God bless you. Are there any others today? Between you and God? But I'd love to pray for you and rejoice with you. Let me ask those of you that already know Christ as Savior and you're going through a trial and you want prayer for that trial, can I pray for you? Would you raise your hand? I see many hands going through trials, going through problems, that you would make the right choices and stand for the Lord no matter what and see Jesus in the midst of that trial. God bless all of you. Father, we're so thankful for your goodness, your love, your grace, that you really do care. Instead of saying, why, God, why would you let this happen to me? Lord, we might want to even get a little bit excited because we're going to see a miracle. We're going to see something great. We're certainly going to be able to glorify you with our decisions and with our life. Lord, help the Spirit of God that now indwells us, help us with the courage to make those right choices and to be a testimony to a lost and dying world. We love you and praise you, dear Father. In Jesus' precious name, we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen.